Hello friends, a very good evening and welcome to my session today on the Companies Act 2013 Part 1. Firstly, I'd like to welcome you to Unacademy, India's largest online learning platform, which gives you resources and courses on various examinations and various topics of your interest and choice, which you would like to revisit time and time again. So, like I said, welcome to Unacademy, India's largest online learning platform. A brief introduction about the educator today, that's me. Well, hello, I'm Pratik Gupta. I am a Bachelor of Commerce from Christ College, Bangalore University. I am an associate member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. I am an associate member of the Institute of Company Secretaries of India, also an associate member of the Institute of Cost Accountants of India, and a law graduate from Karnataka State Law University. Currently, I am into the practice of Chartered Accountancy and also a visiting faculty for CA subjects. And I also teach CA students both offline and online. Prior to starting my own practice, I worked with SR Bartley Bar & Associates, that is the Indian member firm of Ernst & Young Global, in the audit and assurance department. Post that, I worked with Ernst & Young in the mergers and acquisitions department. And then I worked with the Manipal Group as a corporate controller of their Indian and the German entity, and was posted in Germany for a while. Got back from there and I started my own practice. So that's a little brief introduction about me. Hello, Ritija, how are you? So let's proceed with the session. Now, once you subscribe to Unacademy or once you come onto the Unacademy platform, what do you get? Firstly, you get daily live classes where you get to chat with your educator, engage in discussions, ask your doubts and answer all of them while you are going live. Hello Mufid, hello Geeta, welcome and thank you for joining my session. You get live tests and quizzes to help you evaluate your level of preparation, to identify your weak areas and to work on them, and to identify your strength areas to better improve them. The courses provided on Unacademy platform are structured in such a way that they take you step by step into detail of each activity, what is happening, to ensure that your preparation is comprehensive and precise. And most importantly, you get unlimited access to the various resource and content of Unacademy. Content of Unacademy, which you can access at any time of the day according to your convenience and comfort. Be it in the night, be it early in the morning, be it during the day, whenever you think you have enough time to have a quick course or a quick review of a subject matter, you can always go back to Unacademy platform and look at your favorite subject or topic. Hello Rajat, hello Sujata, how are you? I'm good, Ritija, how are you? Okay, for those of you who have not yet downloaded the Unacademy learning app, I request you to download the Unacademy app from your Play Store. It is quite easy and simple. It will ask you for your mobile number and an OTP. You can use your OTP and register on the Unacademy learning app. That will open your doors to the various resources and courses that Unacademy offers to you. Now, Unacademy also provides various subscription packages for the various topics and examinations. Now, currently for the CA Foundation and Intermediate Examination, Unacademy gives you packages for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, and 24 months. The prices for these is given on your screen. You can have a look at them. And while you subscribe, please do not forget to use the code Pratik, P-R-A-T-H-I-K, to get a discount of 10% on your subscription price. So I look forward to all of you taking up the subscription and joining the Unacademy platform very soon. Welcome once again. Now, before we move on, what have we discussed so far? We've discussed a lot about Indian Contracts Act. We've discussed a lot about Indian Partnership Act. We've discussed a lot about a Limited Liability Partnership Act and things like that. Now, this topic, or the topic I'm going to have today, is Companies Act 2013. I'm sure all of you have at least heard of it, if not know the contents of it, but I've heard of what Companies Act 2013 is all about. Companies Act 2013 came into existence, like the year says, in 2013. Prior to this, we had the Companies Act 1956, which went on for a good 50, 57, 60 years. And then we had the Companies Act 2013, which was new and updated to include the more recent provisions. Now, what does the company, before we move on to the slides, what does the Companies Act deal with? Like the name says, the Companies Act deals with companies. Now, who do you think are companies? Now, if you're running a proprietorship firm, a proprietorship concern, or if you're running a partnership firm, or if you're running a trust, or if you're running a association of persons, I mean, we loosely use the terms, right? Oh, I have a proprietorship company. Oh, I have a partnership company. My company is a partnership company and I'm a partner in that. Or I am the owner or the proprietor of my company. So these terminologies, we use it quite frequently and we use it quite interchangeably. Hi, Disha Gupta, welcome to my session. Thank you for joining in. So we use a lot of terminology unknowingly and interchangeably, but please remember, a proprietorship form of organization is called a proprietorship concern. A partnership is called a partnership firm. A company is only a private limited company or a public limited company. That means a company which has been incorporated under the Companies Act 1956, Companies Act 2013, or a Companies Act which came into existence prior to 1956, before independence. So all these, so a company would necessarily mean a private limited or a public limited company only. Whereas your partnership, your proprietorship cannot be a company. Those are all firms and, concerns. So I hope you're clear so far. Yes, can I see a response to know if you're clear so far? All right, thank you so much. Introduction, the Companies Act 2013 was enacted to consolidate and amend the law relating to companies. The Companies Act 2013 was preceded by the Companies Act 1956. We had a Companies Act 1956 for a long time. When I cleared my chartered accountancy course, I studied the Companies Act 1956. Companies Act 2013 has come into existence just about 7-8 years ago. The provisions are more or less similar to 1956 with some important changes. So that's what Companies Act 2013 is. One major change that has come into Companies Act 2013 is it has become more strict and stringent in terms of the top management and the auditors. The responsibility and accountability of the top management, that is your directors, CEO, COO, and your auditors, has increased in the Companies Act 2013. So we'll discuss about that later. Let's now continue. Now, the applicability of the Companies Act 2013, is everyone able to follow me so far? Am I audible? Am I visible? Is it clear? Is there any problem? Please respond and let me know you can hear me and see me clearly. Thank you, Sujata. Thank you, Ritija. All right. And anytime during the course or during the session, if you have any questions, please feel free to ask me at any time. Type in your question there and I will answer it then and there. All right. So the applicability of Companies Act, like I said, Companies Act deals with private limited companies and public limited companies. So what is the applicability of the Companies Act 2013? The provision of the Act applies to companies incorporated under the Act or any other previous company law. Like I told you, if there is any company that is incorporated after 2013, it will come under the Companies Act 2013. If there was any company that was incorporated before 2013, but after 1956, it will come under the Companies Act 1956. If the company was incorporated before 1956, then it would have come under that time's Companies Act. If I'm not mistaken, it was about 1917 or 1918, the Companies Act. So if the company is incorporated under any of the previous Companies Act also, it will be a company under the Companies Act 2013. A company which is incorporated under the Companies Act 1956 will not stand cancelled or superseded when the Companies Act 2013 comes into existence, but it will be absorbed into the Companies Act 2013 and will be required to comply with the provisions of the Companies Act 2013. All right, am I clear so far? Okay, good. Now, the applicability of Companies Act. The Companies Act applies to companies incorporated under this act or any other previous company law. Next, insurance companies, except where the provisions of the said act are inconsistent with the provisions of the Insurance Act 1938 or the IRDA Act 1999. Now, insurance companies, what do you think are insurance companies? Can you name a few insurance companies in India? I would request everyone to participate. Now, what are the insurance companies present in India currently? LIC, okay. Then of late, recently, about a few years ago, there was a privatization in the insurance sector as well, wherein a lot of private players came into it. National Insurance Company, yes, we had Bajaj Alliance, we have Tata AIA, AIG, we have MetLife Insurance, we have SBI Life. So all these are insurance companies. So please remember, there is a separate law for the insurance companies. That is, one is the Insurance Act 1938. One is the Insurance Act 1938, and they have something called as IRDA Act 1999. Any company carrying on, yes, Ritija, SBI Life as well, I named that before itself, all right? So any company intending to carry on insurance business has to get itself registered with the IRDA. What does IRDA stand for? Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority. So there is an act for it called a IRDA Act 1999, which governs the rules and regulations that apply to an insurance company. So every insurance company is expected to follow those guidelines. Then we also have an Insurance Act 1938, which spells out the various procedures and provisions, admin procedures of insurance companies or companies carrying out insurance business, and every insurance company is expected to adhere to those guidelines. Now, you might ask me, how is it applicable? How is the Companies Act 2013 applicable to insurance companies? Please remember, any provision which is not there in the Insurance Act or the IRDA Act 1999 will be covered by the Companies Act 2013. Or if there is a conflict between the provisions of the Insurance Act, IRDA Act and the Companies Act 2013, then the provisions of the Insurance Act and the IRDA Act will stand on top, and the provisions of Companies Act 2013 will not apply as long as it is inconsistent with the provisions of the Insurance Act and the IRDA Act. Am I clear so far? So, like I told you earlier, every insurance company has to adhere to the Insurance Act and the IRDA Act 1999. Banking companies, again, except where the provisions of the said act are inconsistent with the provisions of the Banking Regulation Act 1949. Now, can you name a few banking companies in India? Come on, name a few banking companies in India. Rajat, Sujata, Disha, name a few banking companies. I'm sure all of you have a bank account. All right, a few banking companies to name is ICICI, we have SBI, we have HDFC, we have PNB, Punjab National Bank, we have Jana Small Finance Bank, we have Canara Bank, we have Union Bank, Indian Bank, and Andhra Bank, and a lot of other banks like this. So please remember, all these banks are banking companies. These are, that means, yes, Sujata, ICICI, IDBI, SIDBI, all right? So all these are banking companies. Now, banking companies are companies that carry on the banking operations. So please, again, similar to insurance companies, if there is any company that carries on banking operations, first, the Banking Regulation Act 1949 applies to them, and then if any provision is not contained in the Banking Regulation Act 1949, then they have to follow the Companies Act 2013. Or if there is a dispute between the provisions of the Companies Act 2013 and the Banking Regulation Act 1949, then the provisions of the Banking Regulation Act 1949 will hold good and the Companies Act 2013 will not hold good. But provided these are private limited companies or public limited companies, because the Companies Act applies to only a private limited company or a public limited company. So I hope I'm clear so far. Yes, Hello, Mohammad Mustafa. Welcome to the session. All right. So, any other company governed by any special act for the time being in force? Now, any other company governed by any special act, what could you think of? Could you think of any other company which is governed by any special act? Can we say non-banking financial companies? Non-banking financial companies are those companies that provide the basic functions of a bank, that is borrowing money and lending money to the needy at a fixed rate of interest. Now, for example, NBFCs are Muthoot Finance. We have Shriram Transport Finance, right? Manappuram Finance. All these are not banking companies, but they are non-banking financial companies. So to a large extent, they also have to get registered under the Banking Regulation Act 1949. And adhere to the provisions of the Banking Regulation Act 1949. So if there is any conflict between the provisions of the Companies Act and the Banking Regulation Act, the Banking Regulation Act will prevail and the Companies Act will not prevail. Right? Am I clear so far? Sure. Any other special act that you can think of? All right. Such body corporate which are incorporated by any act for time being, by any act for time being in force, and as the central government may by notification specify in its behalf. Now, from time to time, the central government issues something called as a gazette, the official gazette. So in that gazette, if they mention any other company specifically as a company to be registered, to be administered under the Companies Act 2013, then that company will also be treated and dealt with in the Companies Act 2013. So the last point is a residual point, which includes any other company if the central government thinks so. Am I clear so far? Any doubts, please ask me. Hi Pritesh, welcome to my session. Any questions? All right. Now, company meaning and its features. Section 220 of the Companies Act 2013 defines the term company as: company means a company incorporated under this act or any other previous company law. Like I told you earlier, if a company is incorporated under Companies Act 2013, if it is incorporated under Companies Act 1956, or if it is incorporated under a Companies Act before the Companies Act 1956, it will be termed as a company and will be treated equally under the Companies Act 2013. I hope everyone's clear with that. All right, now what are the features of a company? Quickly, now firstly it says separate legal entity, perpetual succession, limited liability, artificial juridical person, common seal. Now let's discuss each point a little bit more before we move into the slides. Now what do you mean by a separate legal entity? Now can anyone give me the answer what a separate legal entity means? Give it a try. All right, a separate legal entity means once a company is incorporated, it comes into existence, then it becomes a separate entity in its own self. For example, two directors or two people come together and to start off a private limited company. So remember, yes, Sujata, the company and the members are treated as separate body. Exactly. They are, because the company is a separate entity. Now, let me explain that to you. Yes, Sujata, you're right. Now, A and B come together to form a private limited company. Both of them become the directors and the shareholders of the company, and a private limited company comes into existence. A has his PAN card, B has his PAN card. The minute the company is incorporated by the name maybe ABC Private Limited, then ABC Private Limited is a separate legal entity in the eyes of law. It is not the same as A and B. A and B cannot tell you that, oh, I this is my company and I belong and I own the company. No one owns a company. They are then the directors. They manage the company or administer the company on behalf of the shareholders. All right. So once the company comes into existence, it is a separate legal entity. And what do you mean by separate legal entity? By separate legal entity, I mean it can agree, it can enter into agreements and contracts, it can hold assets, it can sue and it can be sued for various reasons. So this, please remember, only a separate legal entity can do it. If there was no separate legal entity, then the company would not be able to hold assets. The company would not be able to sue or get sued, and also will not be able to enter into contracts. Now you might ask me, as a company is non-existent, so how can they enter into contracts? Please remember, a company is not a living person, but still it can enter into contracts with the help of its directors. So directors are the means or the medium through which a company operates and carries on its day-to-day functions. Am I clear so far? All right. Perpetual succession. Now, what do you mean by perpetual succession? Perpetual succession means, okay, does anyone want to try what perpetual succession means? Anyone, give it a try. What does perpetual succession mean? Continuous existence. Yes, can you explain that, Sujata? Hi Suraj, welcome to the session. Yes, Sujata, can you explain that? What do you mean by continuous existence? Okay. Perpetual succession, like Sujata rightly said, means continuous existence. Continuous existence means a company is a separate legal entity. Now, the shareholders of the company might come and go. The directors of the company might come and go. One director might come, the other director might go. One director might pass away. New shareholders will come. The shares will be transferred from one shareholder to the other. All these things keep happening. But remember, A and B had started the company. Maybe after a few years, A and B are not there, C and D have come in, or X and Y have come in, or any new directors and shareholders have come into the company to take over. But does the company cease to exist? No, the company continues to exist irrespective of who the shareholder is or who the directors is. And until and unless the company is officially wound up, the company will continue its existence. Like they say, people will come and go, generations will come and go, but the company will remain until it is officially shut down. So that is what you mean by perpetual succession. Let's take an example. Husband and wife start a company. They start a private limited company, and they get married, and they just start off a new venture. Now they both are the directors and the shareholders in the company. Time goes by, then they get kids. The kids become adults. They include the kids into the company as shareholders and directors. A and B, who started the company, the couple, they grow old, then their children get grandchildren. So then the grandchildren also become adults. Then they are included into the company as shareholders. By that time, A and B get old and they pass away. So who's remaining? Their kids and their grandchildren are in the company. So if this generation thing keeps going on, that one generation comes, one generation goes, in that case, the company, if you see the company's name, the company's existence is still there. It does not matter whether the shareholders and directors came in and went or kept on changing, but the company remained. So that's what you mean by perpetual succession. Perpetual succession or perpetuity means the future, to a reasonable future. All right. Any doubts so far? I hope I'm clear. Okay. The third point is limited liability. Now, limited liability, yes, it is very important. It is one of the major feature or characteristic of a private limited company. The best advantage of a private limited company is the third feature, that is your limited liability. Now, you might ask me how. Does anyone want to explain what limited liability means? Do you want to take a shot? What does limited liability mean? Yes, Geeta, the liability of the members is limited to the shares they held. Yes, I would like to refine that a little bit more. The liability of the members is limited to the amount unpaid on the shares they hold. Am I right, Geeta? Did you miss that point? Yes, you agree with me? All right, all right. Now let me explain the point. Geeta, you're right. Yes, Sujata, the outsider can't claim the personal liability of the member in case of non-payment of shortage of payment. Yes, thank you so much. That was the answer I gave in my morning session. So I'm sure you were there in the morning session as well. Thank you so much. All right. So now let's talk about what is limited liability. Geeta is also right and Sujata is also right. Harsh, welcome to the session. Thank you for joining in. Now, limited liability means the... All right, Sujata, maybe it's a mistake, but your answer was right. Well done. Hi, Sneha. Thanks for joining in. Okay, so let me explain what limited liability is. Limited liability simply means, let's say A and B start off as... hi, Sneha. How are you? All right. A and B start off as shareholders in the company. They buy 5,000 shares each of the nominal value of rupees 10 each. So how much is the value of the shares they hold? 5,000 into 10, 50,000. So A holds 5,000 shares, B holds 5,000 shares, and the total amount that they need to pay to the company is 50,000. That is 5,000 into 10, 50,000. Right? Clear so far? Now, what happened? The company just took 5 rupees from each of them. They did not take the entire 10 rupees from them. So how much did each pay? A paid 5,000 into 5, 25,000. B paid 5,000 into 5, 25,000. So A and B both paid 25,000 into the company. Now, what is the amount that is still unpaid by A and unpaid by B? Can you tell me what is the amount unpaid? The amount unpaid by A is 25,000. The amount unpaid by B is 25,000. Now, the company was carrying on its operations. Everything was okay. But one fine day, the company bought some materials from a vendor worth 5 lakhs. Okay. And they thought that they're going to execute the order. Let's say they were making furniture. So they bought 5 lakh worth hardware from a vendor. And they thought, okay, let me execute the order. And once the order is executed, I will repay I will pay the money to the vendor. But unfortunately things went wrong and they could not pay the 5 lakhs to the vendor of the hardware. So now what happens? The hardware guy asked them for the money. Sir, please give me my money. But the company could not give the money as the company did not have money. Eventually the hardware guy went to the court and he filed a case against the private limited company that the private limited company has purchased 5 lakh worth of goods from me, but they are not paying it back to me. The court said, okay, now whatever the amount the private limited company had to pay. So the court told them, please sell your assets, please liquidate everything and you pay the vendor 5 lakhs. So the company had some furniture, some computers and some receivables. So all that, they accumulated all that money and they could only collect rupees 3 lakhs. What is still pending? 2 lakhs. So the private limited company paid 3 lakhs to the vendor, but how much is still remaining to be paid to the vendor? 2 lakhs. So then the vendor said, no, I want my money. So in this case, the private limited company can only go back to A and B, those are the shareholders, and tell them that, see guys, you owe us 25,000 each for the shares you have bought. Please give us the 25,000. So A and B's liability is limited to only the unpaid amount on the shares held by them. In case they had paid 10 rupees on the share, then there is no liability they have. Their liability is zero. So then eventually A gave 25,000 to the company, B gave 25,000 to the company. That 50,000 was paid to the external vendor. Now, how much was the external vendor supposed to get? 5 lakhs. The company paid the vendor 3 lakhs. And the company also collected 25 from A and 25 from B and paid it to C. So now how much is remaining unpaid to the vendor? 5 lakhs minus 3 lakhs minus 50,000. So 1,50,000. For the 1,50,000, the vendor again went to the court to file a case on the company. And the company said, I'm sorry, I don't have anything more. If he wants, he can maybe take my furniture and sell it off and take it. But I have nothing more. So in this case, you will observe that the shareholders A and B, where their liability were limited only to 25,000 each. And nothing more can be taken from them. So this is one of the biggest advantage of a private limited company where the liability of the shareholders is limited. Is this concept clear? Let me know if you've understood this, because this is a very important concept. If you haven't, please ask me a question and I'll answer it. Let me know in the comment box if you understood this. Thank you, Geeta. What about the others? Sujata, thank you. What about the others and the others who've just joined in? Sakshi, Sophia, hello. Thanks for joining in. Ritija, thank you so much for your response. All right. Now, let's move to the next point, which is artificial jurisdictional person. Now, what do you mean by artificial jurisdictional person? Now, when a company, ABC Private Limited, comes into existence, can someone actually touch it and feel it? Can someone actually take it for a walk? Or can anyone physically feel and hold the company? Hi, Kanish. Thanks for joining in. Sonam Kumari, thanks for joining in. Welcome to my session. So can anyone do that? No, that's why a company is called an artificial jurisdictional person. That means it is a company which is not physically into existence, but legally on paper, it is a separate legal entity and it is into existence. And it does, now you might wonder, how does it function? Like I told you earlier, it functions through its directors or the board of directors who carry out the operations on behalf of the company. Now, jurisdictional person is, again, can a company be arrested? No, a company cannot be arrested. But can a company take legal action against someone? Yes, a company can take legal action against someone. Can someone take legal action against the company? Yes, the third party can take legal action against the company. But max to max, what happens if a company is, if legal action is taken against the company is asked to be wound up. And also the top management that is there in the company, if they are found negligent or careless in doing their duties, then they are also responsible and liable under the Companies Act 2013 to the aggrieved party. Are we clear so far? So even though we call it a person, it is not a person that is physically present. It is not a tangible person. It is a person on paper. It is a living entity on paper. But it functions with human beings. Human beings are the people who drive it. Are we clear with this concept so far? Yes? All right. Now the last part, the last feature of a company, common seal. Now, common seal, what do you mean by common seal? A common seal is a sort of an embossment or a sort of a mark that is made on the official documents by companies stating that, yes, this has been authorized or this has been verified by the company. Companies Act 1956 made it mandatory for a common seal to be in operation, whereas Companies Act 2013 does not make it mandatory for a company to operate with a common seal, but it makes it optional. A few documents require the company's common seal mandatorily, whereas the others don't. So there is a relaxation given in Companies Act 2013 with regards to the common seal as compared to the Companies Act 1956. Now, can anyone explain what a common seal means? Anyone, what is a common seal? Hi, Surya, thanks for joining my session. What is a common seal? Official signature of a company. How does that look like, Sujata? What does the official signature of a company look like? Can you explain that? Sonam Kumari, it's a digital signature. All right. Anyone else wants to try? What is the common seal? Hi, Shriti. Hi, Manjari. Hi, Rajan. Thanks for joining in my session. Thank you so much. Welcome. Yeah, Sujata and Sonam, you want to try any more? No, Sonam, unfortunately, your answer is wrong. It's not a digital signature. Sujata is close. Company seals. Okay, Ritija says, company seals were predominantly used by companies in common law jurisdictions. Can you explain that, Ritija? Am I visible? Am I audible? Can you please respond in the comment box and let me know if I'm visible and audible? All right, okay. So, Ritija, you want to try? You want to expand on your answer? What does a common seal mean? Hi, Amir. Thanks for joining my session. Welcome. All right. See, a common seal normally will be maybe a round, a circular round thing which says ABC Private Limited, Bangalore. Okay, Sujata has given me an answer. Means it works as a signature of the company in case of legal documents as company is an artificial person. Not exactly, Ritija. Sujata, not exactly. And neither is it a digital signature. It is just a common seal simply means a seal that acknowledges or embosses on important documents such as your memorandum of association, articles of association, your share certificates to show that that particular share certificate is authentic and it belongs to the company. It's an original one. It is a slight sort of an embossment which leaves a print, a compression print on the paper on which it is used. Okay, it's like your huge stapler, but instead of stapling or making holes on the paper, it leaves a sign. It leaves an embossment. That is what you call by. That is what you mean by common seal. I hope you got the point. Yes, maybe in the future sessions I will show you what a common seal looks like or what it means. Is everyone clear what a common seal looks like or what a common seal means? Any questions, please ask me. Anyone? Okay, Sujata wants me to repeat. Okay, Sujata, so you want me to repeat what a common seal means? Okay, see, a common seal is sort of an embossment. No, not a stamp. Okay, let me give you an example. When we were kids, I remember doing it. I'm not too sure if you have done it. We used to put a piece of paper on top of something written or something or some sort of a mark. And we used to scratch it with a pencil. And that mark used to come onto the paper. Do you remember that? No, Ritija, it's not a digital signature. So, hi, Barkha. Welcome to my session. Thanks for joining in. So, like I said, when we were kids, you put a piece of paper on maybe your pencil box or your notebook and you scratch it with a pencil. And the whatever was written on your pencil box or book used to come onto the paper, the print. Do you remember that? If you haven't done it, maybe I will suggest you to do it. See, okay, let me give you an example. All of us have debit cards. All of us will have a bank account and will have debit cards, right? So if you look at your debit card, your name over there might be coming up from the card. So put a paper on top of the card and scratch it with a pencil. You will see that your name will appear on the paper when you scratch it with a pencil in dark blue, in dark black shade. I hope you can relate to what I'm saying. Yes, that is sort of a common seal. So that is what happens with a common seal when you use it on a paper. It is embossed. The shape and the design gets embossed on that paper. And it's very slight. You need to look at it very carefully. And then you get to know that the common seal has been used on this. Is everyone clear what a common seal? Sujata, I hope you're clear what a common seal means. Let me know if you've understood it. If not, I'll explain it again. I'll be happy to explain it again. Got it? Okay. If possible, in my other Companies Act sessions, because I will be taking a lot of sessions on Companies Act, I will actually show you the what it looks like. Okay. And I will also show you this pencil thing what I was talking about. Yes, Sonam, now you're asking me whether a common seal is optional or compulsory. Under the Companies Act 1956, it was compulsory, but under the Companies Act 2013, it is not compulsory. It is optional. But a few documents need to have a common seal. Beyond that, it's your choice. If you want, you do it. If you don't want to do it, don't. Okay, clear? Sujata, understood? Sonam, answered your question? Okay, thank you so much. Can we proceed? Okay, now let's look at Whatever I've explained, let's look at it a little bit more in detail. A separate legal entity. When a company is registered, it is clothed with a legal personality. It comes to have almost the same rights and powers as a human being. Its existence is distinct and separate from that of its members. A company can own property, have bank account, raise loans, incur liabilities, and enter into contracts. Like I told you, it can do all the functions what normal human beings do. But through whom do they do it? They do it through their board of directors. As a company is not a person, obviously the company cannot get up and go somewhere, get up and sign. So they do everything through their representatives, which is the board of directors. So that's what a separate legal entity means. They can hold bank accounts. You can, like how you and me have a bank account in our names, a company also has a bank account in its name. Perpetual succession. Members may die or change, but the company, by members we mean shareholders. Members may die or change, but the company goes on till it is wound up on the grounds specified by the Act. The shares of the company may change hands indefinitely, but that does not affect the existence of the company. Since a company is an artificial person created by law, law alone can bring an end to its life. Its existence is not affected by the death or insolvency of its members. I've already explained this point to you. I'll explain it again quickly. Like I told you, members will come and go, directors will come and go, and the shares will change hands. People might buy and sell the shares of the company, but that does not affect the existence of the company. The company has come into existence through law, and it has to end through law. There can be no other ways to end the company. Limited. Limited liability. The liability of a member depends upon the kind of company in which he is a member. We know that company is a separate legal entity which is distinct from its members. Thus, in case of a limited liability company, the debts of the company in totality do not become the debts of the shareholders. In no case can the shareholders be asked to pay anything more than the unpaid value of the shares. I explained it to you. 5,000 shares into 10, 5,000 shares into 10. We also have different kind of companies. So if it is a limited liability, we'll talk about that in the next session about the kind of companies. So if a company which is limited by shares, the example I gave holds good, that the shareholders are not liable to pay anything other than the unpaid amount held on the shares held by them. Any questions so far? Hi Raghavendra. Any questions, Raghavendra, Sujata, anything? Geeta, any questions? Okay. In case of a company limited by guarantee, the members are liable to the extent of the amount guaranteed by them, and that too only when the company goes into liquidation. See, so there is also a company which is also a class of company which is limited by guarantee, which simply means that they guarantee, when they come into the company, they guarantee that in case the company needs money, I will pay so much of money. So in case it is a company limited by guarantee, then the liability of the shareholders is only to the extent of the amount guaranteed by them and nothing more. Now, where will you find the amount guaranteed by them? You will find the amount guaranteed by them in the memorandum of association and nowhere else. So that's why a memorandum of association is a primary document for a company. We will discuss that further. Are you clear so far? Now, there is also a class of company called unlimited company. If a company is an unlimited company, then the liability of the shareholders is not limited. It is unlimited, but let me tell you now itself, starting off an unlimited company in India now is very rare. Normally, most of the companies are companies limited by shares or limited by guarantee, and there are not many unlimited companies that can come into existence or are present. Any questions so far? Anyone, any questions? Please ask. Anyone? All right, can we proceed? All right. Artificial juridical person. A company is an artificial person as it is created by a process other than natural birth. It is legal or juridical as it is created by law. It is a person since it is clothed with all the rights of an individual. Now again, a company was not given normal birth by a human being. So it is an artificial person. It is not a person you can touch or feel. There is no tangible existence of a company, but the company remains on paper, and on paper it is a legal and distinct entity that is present. All right. So it is a person that is clothed with all the rights of an individual. Now, what do you think are the rights an individual has? Can anyone tell me the various rights an individual has? Come on, answer. What are the rights an individual has? Yes, Raghavendra, answer. Sonam, Sujata, Ritija, Geeta. What are the rights of an individual? Prachi, I'm sorry if I didn't get your names, but yeah, let me know what are the rights an individual has. Okay, what could be the rights? The right to existence, the right to carry on trade, the right to hold properties, the right to sue or take legal remedies, the right to undisturbed trade. So these are a few rights that individuals have, and please remember, a company also has all these rights. The only difference is, because it is not a normal person but it is an artificial person, it has to function through its board of directors who take decisions on behalf of the company. Manjari, right to speak. Yes, of course, right to speak. Yes, the company speaks through its representatives, that is the board of directors. Because the company is not into existence, it cannot speak. It does not have a face. It does not have a body. So it cannot speak as such per se. Okay? Sonam, it's right to sue. Yes, it's right to sue means it's right to file a case. If a person, if a customer of the company does not pay the money to the company can file a case against the person in its own name. ABC Private Limited can file a case against XYZ for recovery of money. Yes? Agreed? Sonam agreed. Manjari agreed. Sujata, sir, then how the company can repay its remaining debts in case of limited liability? No, that's what I told you. Yes, Raghavendra, I repeat karunga. Let me just answer Sujata. Sujata ko pehle main answer kar do, fir main aapke question pe aata hu. Sujata, your question is, and how the company can repay its remaining debts in case of a limited liability. See, I gave you an example, right? A has 5,000 shares, B has 5,000 shares. Their liability is limited to the amount unpaid on the shares held by them. Their liability cannot go more than that. So now your question is, in that case, how do you repay? I gave you the example of the external vendor, right? Whereas the external vendor had to be paid 5 lakhs. So the company paid it 3 lakhs. Remaining 25,000 it collected from A, 25,000 it collected from B. And then it paid the vendor. So how much did it pay the vendor? It paid 3.5 lakhs to the vendor. So how much is still remaining unpaid? 1,50,000. Now your question is, how the 1,50,000 will be paid? Am I right, Sujata? Yes or no? Okay, so that's your answer. That's your question. So the answer to that is, the company cannot pay anything more than that. So what does it ask the vendor to do? It asks the vendor to go and file a case in the court, and if required, hello Smriti and welcome to my session. Thank you for joining in. So the vendor can go to the court and ask for winding up of the company, saying that the company is unable to pay my debts. Please order for winding up of the company. And if the court finds everything in order, the court might order the company to be wound up. It might actually appoint a liquidator who will liquidate all the assets of the company, repay all the money to all the debtors, all the creditors and debts. And if there is any money remaining, give it to the shareholders. So to answer your question, then how does the company repay its remaining debts? In case it does not have any money, even after collecting it from the shareholders, the company may be wound up. Right? So the creditor might go to the court and ask for the company to be wound up, because then the company becomes dangerous, right? Today it did not pay one vendor, so it owes him 5 lakhs. Out of 5 lakhs, it could pay him only 3.5 lakhs. So 1.5 lakhs was still pending. So tomorrow they might go to another vendor, take materials from him and not pay him. Third day they might go to another vendor, take materials from him and not pay him. So in that case, the Companies Act gives a right to the vendors to go and file in court for liquidation or winding up of such a company. Clear? Answer your question, Sudhakar. All right, anyone else, any other question? Okay, a company being an artificial person is not bestowed with the body of a natural being. Therefore, it works through the agency of human beings. Common seal is the official signature of the company, which is affixed by the officers and employees of the company on its every document. The common seal is a seal used by corporation as a symbol of its incorporation. Even though it says signature, please remember it's not a signature like you and me do on a paper. It is an embossment on the piece of paper. Okay, now all of us know what a watermark is. Let me try explaining to you again what a common seal means. All of us know what a watermark is. Watermark is, let's say you get some document from a lawyer's office, or let's say you get another document and in the background, very lightly you see confidential or draft or dispose after reading. Very lightly if you see sort of a thing written on a piece of paper, like a watermark. Yes, so the common seal is also something very similar to a watermark, which appears in the background. It is like a symbol. So that is a common seal. There is no signature. There is no physical signature like how you and me do. Neither is it a digital signature. And a company is not a natural being, so a company cannot sign. Are we clear? Any questions on common seal? Please ask. Okay, now this is a very important topic, corporate veil theory. Let me tell you right now that as we just have another 10 more minutes in this session. Hi, Vikash Pathak, thanks for joining in and welcome to my session. We will discuss what this theory means, and I have a lot of case laws pertaining to this, which I will be discussing in my next session. So I request all of you to attend the next session for going through all the case laws relating to corporate veil theory. Now let's just quickly run up and brush up on what do you mean by corporate veil theory. Corporate veil refers to a legal concept whereby the company is identified separately from its members of the company. The term corporate veil refers to the concept that members of a company are shielded from the liability connected to the company's actions. If the company incurs any debts or contravenes any laws, the corporate veil concept implies the members should not be liable for those errors. Right? Now, this is also a little bit connected to Sujata's question. Sujata, you asked me a question saying, if in case of a limited liability, how does the company repay its debts? Right? That's what you asked me. So I will bring in that question again. Now, corporate veil simply means, hi Vaishnavi Chopra, thanks for joining in. Welcome to my session. Okay, so corporate veil simply means, like we read in the essential features of a company, that a company is a separate, distinct legal identity. It is separate from its members, right? We read that, and it's got a separate legal existence. So a lot of times, what does the Companies Act do? The Companies Act gives protection to its members, that is the shareholders of a company, through a concept known as corporate veil. If you actually see the meaning of veil, veil means a sort of a, what do you call it? Curtain, a sort of a curtain or a thing where the face is covered. Okay, and that is called a veil. So corporate veil simply means this curtain or this cover is placed in front of the members, which is shielding them from the actions of the company. So in case the company owes any money to anyone outside, the members should not be harmed. In case the company does anything wrong, the members should not be harmed. So that is the concept of corporate veil, wherein the corporate veil gives protection to the members of the company. By members, I mean shareholders, from the actions and wrongdoings of the company. Am I clear? Any questions, please ask. Anyone, any questions? We will proceed with this. Okay, now there is a leading case, which is Solomon versus Solomon and Co. Limited. This is a leading case law, which brings out the concept of corporate veil theory very clearly. Let's just quickly run through this case law and let's see if we have time to discuss it today or we'll discuss it in the next session. Now, the House of Lords laid that the company is a person. First and foremost, let me tell you, you hear the terms as House of Lords and all this in this because remember I told you there is a Companies Act 2013, there was a Companies Act 1956 and there was also a Companies Act which was before independence. So this case law basically pertains to the Companies Act before independence. So if you can imagine, the lifting of corporate veil theory was present from then and it holds good even today in Companies Act 2013. Clear? All right. The House of Lords laid down that a company is a person distinct and separate from its members. By the House of Lords, you simply mean the court. In this case, one Solomon incorporated a company called Solomon & Co. Limited with 7 subscribers consisting of himself, his wife, 4 sons and 1 daughter. So initially what it means, a person called Solomon started a company with 7 subscribers. That is Solomon, his wife, his 4 sons and 1 daughter. So that is 7 of them started a company called Solomon & Co. Limited. The company took over the personal business assets of Solomon for £38,782 and in turn Solomon took 20,000 shares of ₹1 each. So what happened? Solomon had certain assets. All right. So Solomon started a company, a private limited company along with 6 of his family members and then took over those assets worth £38,782 and in turn Solomon took 20,000 shares in the company at £1 each. Right. So he paid the company £1 each. So what happened? His personal assets were there. That was sold to the company for 38,000. He got £38,000. From those £38,000, he paid £20,000 to the company and bought 20,000 shares. Everyone with me so far? Hi, Harshit. Thank you for joining in. Welcome to my session. Debentures worth £10,000 of the company with a charge on the company's asset and the balance in cash. Okay, so now with £20,000, he not only bought 20,000 shares. Okay, with that £38,000, what did he do? First thing is he bought 20,000 shares and he also took over debentures worth £10,000 of the company with a charge on the company's assets and the balance in cash. All right, so what happened? Let me explain it again. £38,000 the company paid him to take over his business assets. So he had £38,000. With those £38,000, he bought 20,000 shares of £1 each. Then he took over, he bought 10,000 debentures worth £10,000. And then the remaining amount he brought in as cash. Are we clear so far? All right. Subsequently, the company went into liquidation due to general trade depression. The unsecured creditors to the tune of £7,000 contended that Solomon could not be treated as a secured creditor of the company in respect of the debentures held by him, as he was the managing director of a one-man company, which was not different from Solomon, and the cloak of the company was a mere sham and fraud. It was held by law. Okay, now I'll quickly tell you what this means. Now, the whole case law says Solomon had a proprietary business. He started a private limited company, Solomon & Co. Limited. The Solomon & Co. Limited took over the private assets or the private business of Solomon for £38,000. From that £38,000, he bought 20,000 shares or £1 each. He took over 10,000 debentures. So once you take up a 10,000 debentures, debenture holders are secured creditors or unsecured creditors. They are secured, right? It's debentures always considered as a secured loan. And the remaining amount of maybe £8,000, he put in as cash. The company went on, it did a little bit well. But eventually the company went into depression and went into bankruptcy. So there was one external vendor to whom the company had to pay £7,000. Now, if you read the chapter on liquidation of companies, please remember that whenever a company goes into liquidation, first the outside liability, first the government taxes are cleared, then your salaries and other things are cleared, and then your secured loans are cleared. So debentures always considered as secured loans. So obviously Solomon had 10,000 debentures. So Solomon said, okay, I want my 10,000 debentures to be paid before you pay the 7,000 rupees or pounds to the sundry creditor. Now, is that right according to you? According to me, it is not, because Solomon is the owner of the company. So he himself bought debentures of the company. So how can he get the money before the sundry creditor is paid? So the sundry creditor took the company to court and told him that this is Solomon, and he is just playing the fool. He's trying to cheat by being a debenture holder. So please, I need my 7,000 pounds. The company lifted the corporate veil, or pierced the corporate veil, looked at the transaction in totality and decided that yes, what the sundry creditor is claiming is right. So the sundry creditor was awarded pound 7,000 before the debentures of Solomon could be clear. Am I clear? Yes? Anyone has any questions? Was it clear to everyone? Yes, if it was clear to everyone, I thank each of you to attend the session. Thank you so much for being part of this. I will be taking the next session very soon. You will get the notification. Please do attend that session to know more about the case laws relating to corporate veil and lifting of corporate veil. Thank you so much for being a lovely audience. Thank you. Pratik Gupta signing off.